today we are going to cover one more new topic called motivation under organizational behavior. So I'll add the index and you can directly move on to the related topic. So let's get started. So first thing, motivation. So in Greek, motivation means moving, okay? And it's a psychological process of driving an individual to reach certain goals, okay? First topic of our motivation is the characteristics of motivation. So in that, first is the primary motivation. So this is a very basic level, things which motivates us, things which are required for surviving. So those things, which, if they are motivating, then we call it as primary motivation. So here, primary motive is nothing but primary things which are motivating us, secondary things which are motivating us, and the combined of primary and secondary things which are going to motivate us is known as general motives. So let's go one by one. Primary motives. So if food, shelter, clothes, if those things are not there, we'll be motivated to survive, have those things. Okay. So this kind of motivation is primary. And then after we crossed our primary motives, we are entitled to have a good amount of, like, a good dignity status. We want some power. We want a good house and rich. So those kind of things will lead us to secondary motivations. Now, if finally we see, so the in the final, the general motives, we have curiosity, manipulation, and affection. So these things are considered as the hybrid motivation factors. So here we had, like, for suppose, curiosity, like, that can be like, why I'm not having any kind of good clothes, what is, like, curiosity may be for the primary items or maybe secondary items. Again, affection, it might be again for primary items or secondary items. So that's why we call it as a hybrid, and it is a final, that is general motives. Okay, now next we'll see the four approaches of motivation. So first is instinct approach. So we generally believe that when a person is born, he is born with instincts which could help an individual to survive. So in those those instincts, if they are letting us to do something, we call those as instinct approach, because here we are not intentionally doing anything, but to in order to survive we are doing something. So that is called an instinct approach. Now this is again related to primary motivation. Next is the drive reduction approach. So this is proposed by Clark Hull. What it says that suppose we are in a good state, okay, we are in a stable state, but suddenly something happened, okay, because of which we are again, there is something called primary motivation second, okay, we try to get the basic needs, we try to cover our basic needs like food, shelter, clothes, and then after we are done with those physiological needs, we again get back to the stable state. So it says that deviation from homeostasis, that is the stable state, when we get deviated, we again cover our physiological needs, and then we again back to our stable state. So that is drive reduction approach. And next is incentive approach. So this simply states that if we know that if I do something, I would get some kind of reward. So that is like if we have a desire of incentives of or reinforcements, then we do such things. So if you don't know about reinforcement, you can refer to the learning chapter where we have studied about positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement. But either of them, both, if reinforcement is there, it is good for the individual. Now our final approach is the cognitive approach. Here if we see, here there is no factor of surviving, or there is no factor of incentives or something, okay? It's simply when we try to do something, and if we know the value of that thing, that particular task, the more depth we know that if I do this, this will be the outcome. So if that is the scenario, then our cognitive, that is our neurons, brain neurons, it will motivate us to do certain tasks with complete dedication. So this kind of approach we call it is a cognitive approach, in which our brain, because we know what is the output of that thing, we get motivated and we try to perform the task. Okay, next is theories of motivation. So we have 11 theories, we'll go one by one. First is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So this hierarchy is of 5 stages. One is physiological, safety, social esteem, self-actualization. Okay, so once we are done with the physiological, we move on to the next. So in that way, this hierarchy is there. So physiological needs means basic primary things which are needed for surviving. Once we got those needs, once we are good with the physiological needs, we next move on to the next step, that is safety needs. So here we try to invest or try to get education, vaccination, insurance. So once we are good with the safety and physiological, we move on to the third, that is social needs. So here our interest get to the friendship, acceptance, belonging, celebration. So here we are not thinking about safety and physical health. Since that is done, we try to get a good status, good sort of items, dignity in the social. Okay, next is the esteem needs. So here the complete focus is on dignity, status. Okay, we try to get good cars, we try to move in expensive transports and everything. Next is self-actualization needs. So in this stage, it's like, okay, one person has completed all the four states, all the four steps or all the four stairs of the hierarchy, and now he is like, okay, I should do something for the society. So in that case, he realizes that, okay, I've done everything, now it's time for me to contribute back something to the society. So that is something called self-actualization needs. So this is at the the top of the hierarchy. So once ABCD is done, then we move on to this. Now the next theory is Herzberg's two-factor theory. So here two-factor theory means the theory speaks about two factors, of course. So first thing is positive. Okay, so what it states that there are certain items which if present could motivate a person, but if those are absent will not affect. I'll repeat this. If certain things are present, it will motivate a person, but if those are not there, it will not affect. Okay, similar to that, we have negatives. Okay, so in that negatives in the sense absence. So it says that absence of certain things, okay, will definitely lead to dissatisfaction, but presence of those things will not affect. Okay, I'll repeat this again. Absence of something will lead to dissatisfaction, but presence will not lead. Okay, so that was one fact. So here is an example I have taken, pay status. So if pay is absent, it will create dissatisfaction, but if it is present, it will not create satisfaction, but it will not lead a person into dissatisfaction. So these things, okay, in the absence of this we'll have a dissatisfaction, but presence will not make a difference. Similarly, if I see meaningful, challenging, so presence of these things will lead to satisfaction, but absence will not affect. So that is what two-factor theory of Herzberg states. Now next is Alderfer ERG theory. So here ERG means existence, relatedness and growth. What it says is that whatever we studied in Maslow's hierarchy of needs, it is simply modifying that. What it is saying that physiological and safety needs, which are segregated in the Maslow's theory, that comes under existence. Okay, so if physiological needs are there and safety is not there, we cannot exist. That's what this thing. So this ERG theory states. So it merged physiological and safety needs into existence. Similarly, belongingness and merged to relatedness. So here, if you see belongingness and merged to relatedness. So if I go to Maslow's theory, I can see social needs and esteem needs are termed in the ERG theory as differently, but both social needs and esteem needs are merged into relatedness in the ERG theory. Next, final is the self-esteem is self-actualization. So this self-esteem is coming under relatedness as well. Plus, if self-esteem is there, we are good with the relatedness state, but still we are hunger for the self-esteem. Okay, we got some level of self-esteem, we are good with our dignity, we are good with our status, but still we are not satisfied. So in the growth stage, what we say, my self-esteem will grow continuously, plus in this I am also going to contribute to society. So growth means my realization contribution of society will grow, and my dignity, my status will also grow. So those two are merged in growth. Now coming to difference between Maslow's and ERG theory is that in ERG theory we have only three stages, correct? ERG. So what it says that if existence we are done, so then we move to next step, that is relatedness. And if we are not able to survive in the relatedness, we fall down to existence. So here we have something like, if we don't go to the next level, we are again in the same level. So this point slightly conflict with the Maslow's theory. And the second difference is, at any given point of time, we might have multiple needs like physiological and safety needs, compared to Maslow's theory where at any given point we have only one need. Okay, so that was ERG theory. Now final theory is McClelland's need theory. So if you see, all these theories are coming under our content theories, which says what lies in motivation. Okay, so if you keep the statement in mind and if you see what McClelland's need theory says, that the person is derived by three things, like his motivation, his task which he is doing is completely derived by either of these things or the combination of these things. One is achievement, next is power, and next is affiliation. So for example, achievement, we have taken for example Shah Rukh Khan. For power, we have taken Hitler, or affiliation. Here we cannot say, in power we cannot say Modi, okay, because it's not only power which we can say. Like if a person is only concentrating on power, we say it as a, okay, we have taken example. But if it's a combination, then it might be different. Similarly, if and coming to affiliation, we have grow together, sabka saath sabka vikas, similar to that. Okay, now that was our these are our learning theories which are coming under content theories, which says what lies in motivation. But okay, let me give you. So in theories of motivation, we have two categories. One is content theories, which says what lies in motivation. This is the first part. And second part is our process theories, which talks about how motivation happens. So out of the 11 theories, we have 4 theories in content theories, remaining we have in process theories. So first is our Vroom's expectancy theory. So what we are saying here, if you see the diagram, here if you see what we are saying, the person is assuming that okay, certain level of effort will give me this much amount of performance. So this has this perception of a person is known as effort performance relationship. Similarly, we have one more thing. Okay, if I want this much reward, I need to perform this much. So this performance reward relationship is again second perception of a person. But this will come only after the first stage, that is effort performance relationship is done. Now the final thing is where the rewards we got, and now we see the rewards which I got, is it sufficient for my personal goal? Like is it fine, the effort which I kept and the rewards which I expected, is it okay, is it compatible with what my personal goals are? So these three relationships is mentioned under Vroom's expectation theory. So this theory is important because the next theories which are coming up are either modifications of this theory or either extension of this theory. Now next we have Potter's performance satisfaction theory. So as we have seen previously, we had three relationships. Similarly, we have again the same relationships in here. So if you see, first we have effort performance relationship. So here we have expectancy, saying will my effort lead to a high performance. Here it's again the relationship between performance and efforts, the first relations that we have read in Vroom's theory. So if you can see, first relations is effort performance. Now next is, will my performance lead to the desired outcomes? So this is again similar to performance reward relationship, that is instrumentality. Do I found outcome desirables? Okay, the rewards that I got, is it compatible with my personal goals? Now what is the difference? If Vroom has already defined it, why Potter is defining it again? Okay, so Potter's diagram is different. What Potter is saying, that unlike the theory which is suggested by Vroom, which is saying either one of these relationship will be existing at any given point of time, but the study done by Potter, what he is saying, that performance, okay, effort, or the rewards, they are the factor of the motivation behind a person, but they are not the only one. Okay, and at any given point of time, there might be a hybrid combination of these three, and which are again only these three are not the one which could help a person to motivate. Okay, so two things. One is either the hybrid combination of those three. Second is, not only these three, but there are many other factors also which could help a person to get motivated. It might be the past experience, or it might be the revenge, or such kind of things. Okay, so here we have different terminologies. Let me just brief one of them. So effort is the amount of hard work that a person is doing on any task completion. Value of rewards is the expected value of the rewards. It's not the rewards. Rewards is what we get. It might be again internal satisfaction, monetary, non-monetary rewards. but value of rewards is what is expected by the person who is doing effort. Okay, then yeah, we have equity theory. So what equity theory says that the input that is given by an employee or any person who is doing any task, it should be balanced by the output of that task. Okay, I'll repeat, the input given to a task by a person should be balanced by the output given by the task. Now why is this important? This is important to maintain a productive relationship between an employee and employer. So let me we can see here the inputs examples are hard work, skill, tolerance, enthusiasm. There are many others. These are just some of them. Okay, now the output is compensation, benefits, recognition. Okay, right. So if we can see, it is good for the productive relationship. And then it's okay, the story states that the input and the output should be equalized. Okay, so that was our equity theory. Next is our reinforcement. So again, we have studied in detail about the reinforcement. So this is a motivation topic. If you want to know in detail about the reinforcement, you can get back to the learning topic, and there you can see what is the positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, punishment, extinction. And again, within punishment, we have studied about positive punishment, negative punishment. Okay, now finally, motivation in practice. So like I said, apart from what we have studied, the three factors, the performance, efforts, okay, and rewards, apart from this, we have a number of other things which apart from which Broom has mentioned, we have something mentioned by Porters as well. So those are this monetary or non-monetary benefits, job enrichment, job rotation. So job rotation means when you are playing a specific role in the team, you might get expertise on that, but again, to maintain your mood, to have a different set of work, you will be continuously trying to change your position. Not position in the sense, not authority level, it might be the work that you are doing. Again, goal settings, alternative working schedule, employee skills upgradation. So all those things will motivate a person to learn something new, to do something. So that was all about motivation. If you have any queries regarding this, you can please comment down in the comment section. I'll have the link of the learning topic in the description, which you can go through the reinforcement section. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.